name is Marisol Berrios Miranda, and I am a Puerto Rican by birth, and I am an ethnomusicologist by training. So I got my PhD at the University of California, Berkeley. It is very fascinating, history and development of salsa, because as we know it right now, it's a very commercial form, and what people know most about it is the kind of the ballroom dancing and nightclub dancing, and people go to dance studios to learn how to dance. I grew up learning how to dance in the family living room.
I have never danced salsa in my life before. This is a new experience.
Viernes Social, Social Fridays, is a very common, typical practice where, you know, people who come from working class communities, they don't have the money to go out there dancing in nightclubs or anything like that. So we gather at our homes and play records and dance within the, you know, the family context. So I always do a contrast between how I learned how to dance salsa, the history and development of that, and how the history and development of salsa after it became really internationalized in the 1970s. There's two, I think there was this parallel development between the salsa, such as a genre, it developed between Puerto Rico and New York. It's fundamentally based on Cuban, Afro-Cuban music. The son, the Cuban son, the Cuban guaracha, the Cuban danzón and danza. But, you know, in the Caribbean, these two, especially these two countries, also the Dominican Republic, but Cuba and Puerto Rico share a lot of culture. There was always back and forth, and always, oh, before even the Columbus arrival to the Caribbean cuenca, there has been a lot of sharing of culture and in every aspect of culture, being literature, music, dance, paintings, politics as well. Mm. So, but the salsa as a genre as such began to come together as a different style from, for example, the Cuban son and the guaracha in New York in the 1970s, late 60s. After the Cuban Revolution in 1959, there was a rupture between the communication between the Cubans who were constantly coming from the island to New York. And then there's two major figures in the development of salsa in New York who are Willie Colon, the trombone player, and then Eddie Palmieri. Eddie Palmieri had been trained professionally. He took piano lessons from a very early age. And he began then infusing this core of sones and guarachas and mambos with a Puerto Rican country music, jíbaro music flavor. And then he added some Brazilian music and African music and other Caribbean styles. And in that fusion, then came a different sound with the trombone being at the center of the sound of salsa music in New York, and this happens in the 1960s, 70s. And then the Fania record label picked up wave of great music that was being, and the community was fascinating. And they were packing community centers. And every corner when they played, they were just people coming, and the industry picked up. And then they created the Fania record label, who began to produce a lot of salsa music, and then it went international.